I'm always happy to be in New York because I got my film training here. And so when I come back, it's always a pleasure to share my work, you know, about our experience as Chinese in America. So many of you recognize and know, as I was speaking to my new friend in the back of the room, how invisible our histories have always seemed, you know, growing up as we had, being taught about Plymouth Rock and, you know, really? Mayflower, really? You know, it didn't relate to, it was hard to relate to, certainly, as we were growing up. And so it has been my pleasure and privilege to not only learn about the Chinese history that I didn't know about, but what really we share in common, you know, as we tell these stories, our unique, very unique histories, but how, in fact, there are so many universals in the storytelling. This one in particular, especially for those immigrants who came prior to 1965, this is the history more of the southern Chinese who came here, the Pearl River Delta. Are some of you from that? Descendants of Pearl River Delta, right? So, you know, because of Chinese exclusion, which was the first and only time that a group was barred based on race, and it became the model for other policies, immigration policies to restrict immigration. So I think it's particularly timely to really look at the long history of immigration and discrimination and how this has a lingering effect. It casts a very long shadow. And even for those who've immigrated here post 65, it's hard to erase that shadow that was in operation for 61 years from 1882 till 1943 when it was repealed. So this, though, is a very personal story, and it really talks about the ways in which I could finally get the story out from my mother, because as typical, they didn't talk, and you were not going to get them to talk. So I was lucky because I had a real good partner, and that was my daughter. So in this film, you'll see how it has affected us through the generations. And as I always encourage young people, if you have grandparents who live or, you know, elders in your family, say it's for a homework assignment. They'll open up. But when I was trying, boy, my mother was... So anyway, enjoy the film, and I'll be here to take questions and have a conversation. Thank you.
I didn't really know my mother. She spent most of her life hiding who she was.
Just leave me alone, and where I come from, how did I get to America, is nobody's business.
It would take half a century and thousands of miles to uncover the secrets of her story. A journey into the heart of my own American family.
I think you're referring to what was called a confession program, in which you could come and say, you know, I did come with a paper name. There were not a lot of people who did that. One, because it would have been like a house of cards, right? If you come up, if you fess up, then that could affect all the other people that were or were not related to you. If you ever get an opportunity to see what a folder from the National Archives looks like, the cover sheet will have somebody's name, and then it'll list all the people related to you. And in each instance, it'll say the alleged brother, the alleged son, the alleged... Everything starts with alleged. So there's an assumption of guilt already, like, we don't believe who you are. And that's why the interrogations were so rough on people when they came through Angel Island. So, and you were right, you know, if you did fess up, then you would have had to go through the citizenship process again, because most, I would say the majority of people who came as paper sons and daughters came as the minor age child of a citizen, so that you already had citizenship. Because, you know, the exclusion law also meant you could not become a citizen, and until it was repealed could you become a citizen. Even then, and for the Japanese, it was even later in the 50s that they could become citizens, naturalized citizens. So that's why the epilogue was very important, and also to see who's becoming citizens. You know, the complexion of our community and America is changing. And we're feeling backlashes of that as well, aren't we? Yes?
So to follow up on that, in in that excerpt where you were speaking to those swearing in, you specifically included the word constitutionally were American. With our current society and all these things, how do you identify, how do you reconcile all these events in, I guess, identity?
I'd say one of the privileges of getting older is that you can be whoever you want to be. I don't have to defend it, define it, or anything. But what was important within that process was to find out where I fit within the American, white America, right? So that's why I think that it was critically important for those of us who were interested in looking at what that meant, was to really begin finding out what that meant. You know, who were we? You know, apart from perhaps a mention of the railroad workers, you really didn't know who the Chinese were, even though we grew up around our own communities and people had to set up parallel worlds to survive in those early years. And so in that, I was very lucky because as I was uncovering the story, just from my own ignorance, I was also able to apply that into the craft of filmmaking, and then also to try to find a way in which to express the stories in such a way so that it would tap into our common humanity. So that if I did a film about Angel Island Immigration Station, I wanted, say, a farmer who was looking at it, you know, in Iowa, say, oh, well, that's interesting. I can see why, you know, to create a more empathetic, compassionate world, you know, and that's, you know, certainly my goal as I make my film project. It's very specific, but then, you know, any immigrant, I don't think you have to be Chinese to appreciate what this story is about. It's every immigrant story. They're just different shades, right, and different kind of twists. You learn a lot, and you know, I guess in the process what I realize is that I'm the granddaughter of a heroine. You know, this is grandmother who had very little, and in a culture in which, you know, they always push out the boys. She had two daughters, but she made a point of getting them out of China. And for me to really learn about my mother's life, I had to look at the folder of my aunt, who came as, even though she was in an arranged marriage, she didn't have to lie about her past or her life, you know, living in China. So it was through reading her interrogation that I was able to learn more about how my mother's life was, because hers was about this other person, right? So, but imagine that. I mean, to me, each discovery to have to go to a family who just lost their daughter and say, will you take mine in your dead daughter's place? You can't make these things up, you know. And yet they, you know, she was so determined to get her daughter out of, for safety, she was willing to take that risk. Yes?
I'm just curious if you have a view on the difference between American-born Chinese versus, like, China-born Chinese.
From what respect?
Like, in other words, like, I feel very grateful that I'm here today and I got to see this. Uh-huh. So what kind of audience or people or group of people that you're hoping the most to share this film with?
Well, you know, one really aims for the broadest possible audience, period. You know, I would say the first thought that came to mind when you asked that question is that in the 70s, when we started seeing Asians run for office or take on important positions, in San Francisco anyway, this was true, they tended to be educated immigrants, Chinese, who came, they never felt like they were a minority because they came from the majority culture. So they didn't have that kind of insecurity that we had, born here, feeling like second-class citizens. There's one aspect, one way of answering your question. In terms of the China-born, depending on when they came, too, there is sometimes, like I say, people who say, well, you know, we were not poor Southern Chinese. You know, we didn't have that history. That doesn't relate to us. But in as much as, you know, money and education will protect you to a certain point. But we can see that our scientists have been accused of being spies. And, you know, it does to a certain extent, you know. And so I think it's really essential, or what's important is if we can just learn a little bit more about our individual histories, because it's not that we're all so different, you know, in terms of how the outer world might view us. So I think that it behooves us to have a little bit of understanding of that. I think, you know, I have also heard people say, well, let's not talk about the past. Why get stuck in that place, you know, and, you know, it's already over and it's not that important. But yet, you know, it's not so much to become victimized, to, you know, identify as victims, as much as I feel like we've triumphed over a lot of those challenges, for sure. But neither is it to whitewash it. And so, you know, when we were working on preserving the immigration station, we would never say, you know, there were some people that say, well, we'll throw in money if you just highlight all our successes. And that, and, you know, many of us said, you know, that's not the whole story. You know, we need to tell the story as it is and what's true about that past. And the poetry was carved on the walls because people were in pain and anger and struggling for making that sacrifice and risk of coming to this country. So, you know, it's a complicated question in many respects because I think there's so many ways in which to look at it. Yeah.
Daughter identify herself as American or mixed?
Yeah, she's biracial. And I think that it seems to me, her generation in general, and maybe true of you too, is that that kind of identity politics, if you will, when we were coming up, doesn't seem to be as essential because, you know, the world is a little bit looser. You know, never mind what's going on. Generally, among people to people, I think that all of us have been more accepting. You know, there's been much more out marriage. You know, the just the level of kind of tolerance has been emerging just because it's just what's happening. You know, people are moving out. They're not necessarily in conclaves anymore, and so there's more out marriage, as I say, and then more mixed race children, and therefore all of these affects our feelings about the history. So it's movable, and you know, I mean, I think that if anything, there's like a fear, like, oh, will we lose our sense of who we are after we struggled with it so much? You know, these are all shades of gray, you know, and how you want to live it out, but. For each of us, we have to just decide. I don't think we should have to decide, like, I'm either this or I'm that. You know, we're all a lot of different things. No. Yes?
So I wanted to really comment that you really have a gift that your mother could communicate with you in English. Mm-hmm. I'm the first generation born here, and I didn't have that ability. And I told my daughter, I said, you know, it's amazing that we can talk to each other, we can talk about our feelings and what we went through, but I couldn't do that with my mother because I didn't have that level of communication with her.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate the fact that you could do that with your mother and your daughter could.
Well, my daughter mostly did it with my mother, you know. And the thing is that, you know, between the two sisters, like my aunt who came here when she was 18 and started having a family right away, she never had, you know, she didn't go to the high school that my mother went to and got a command of the English language. She was more of a Chinatown mom, so she didn't have that. But in a way, what I learned more about the culture was more from my aunt, my ima, than my mom. Because my mother was very modern. You know, she had the advantage of language. She had a fair amount of guts. And she went for it, you know.
She
came younger, you know, and she had a few years where she wasn't married. So she had time to, you know, develop interests in, and I guess gain more self-confidence, you know. But I know, I hear what you're saying, and I'm really pleased at the fact that she was able to be open to my daughter. There's one piece in the film where you hear my mother's voice, and that is when I go to Cuba. And you hear my mother saying, you know, my father was no good, you know, he abandoned us. And the reason why I have that is at the time I was going on the trip, my mother left me that message on my answering machine, before digital answering machines, you know, on the little mini cassettes. And I'd never heard her so emotional before. You know, it wasn't just being angry, it sounded pain, you know, it had lots of different shades to it. And I just pulled it out because I was just looking at it and I thought, this is a different mom. You know, I mean, she really seemed very vulnerable. You know, I just sat and heard about it. And so I pulled it out, not knowing that one day I would use it in the film, but it was probably, in terms of audio resources, the most honest thing I could share with you. And what was a revelation for me is about how she, at that point in her life, still was holding on to so much pain, you know, and shame. I mean, it was a lot of mixture of things, so that's why I think it helped me understand that there was something good about my going to Cuba and trying to find out what I could on her behalf. Because it, up to that point, it didn't occur to them that maybe he just didn't send money because he was too poor to. That it wasn't that he didn't care about them. He just couldn't. And so, you know, I think that that man, Raphael Lee, or Lee Choi, you know, was a good stand-in to just show a different side of what life was for the Cuban Chinese. Yeah?
Just out of curiosity, because I think my family is very similar to yours, mm-hmm. and I'm kind of surprised that there's so many Chinese in Cuba, because there's actually another documentary by a Hong Kong film professor about
the opera singers?
Opera singers.
Yeah, I saw it.
Just
yeah.
Come out now.
Yeah, I just saw it.
I was really shocked that there is so many Chinese in Cuba.
There was at
my
one point.
Came to Cuba, yeah. At that time, a lot of people come to Cuba to come up to Ellis Island.
Yeah.
So I guess a lot of them got stuck in there somehow.
Well, what happened was at one time, I mean, I'm talking about the 20s and 30s, there was the largest Chinese population in Cuba. And then they mostly died off. There may be 100 Chinese. I mean, there was a lot of outmarriage, if you could afford it, you know. And so there are a lot of mixed race, second, third generation Chinese Cubans. The path, and what was interesting, I mean, you just saw a little bit of the life in for the Chinese in Cuba, but they still have their family associations. And what happened was that some Chinese also went to Cuba in 1949 during the Chinese Cultural Revolution. And then in 1959, there was a revolution in Cuba. So some of the Chinese who could afford to left. Many of them came to New York and opened the Chinese-Cuban restaurants.
Right? Actually, my grandfather, I think he married and have a lot of kids. Uh-huh. And the last thing I heard is like in 1959, both of the kids came to Miami.
Uh-huh.
And I think he stayed behind and he probably died there.
Uh-huh.
And I think probably potentially got a lot of relatives in Miami that I don't know of.
Did he marry a Cuban woman or a Chinese woman? Cuban woman.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, that was, well, you know, there weren't that many Chinese women there.
In some way, I mean, yeah, I think my grandmother never had any communication my grandfather.
Again, right. Yes, Anthony.
Can you just discuss the production of the film, the process, and did your mom get to see any rough cut of this film before passing away?
She had seen some bits of it. She saw the Cuba pieces, and my mother died in 2001, and the trip to Cuba was in 1998. So she didn't see a lot of it. And it took me a long time to make this film. I would say a lifetime, to be honest. You know, I mean, because of the personal nature of the story, even in how to tell it, because there were the particulars about the family, but what I wanted to know and what I was learning was, why did my mother say, don't date Japanese, that they killed my parents, you know, all of that stuff, which were one-liners to them as we're growing up, meant nothing to me. Like, what do you mean? This guy was born here like me, you know. So, you know, to understand how the Japanese invaded China, or, you know, prepared for war with China and was in the villages. That stuff was things I learned. And the historical footage that you see, of course, really helps illustrate what was going on. So even as I'm telling my particular story, I'm trying to also let you know the context, the historical context, because at the very end, like I say, it never occurred to me, that all these things, that the decisions that were made for my grandmother to get her daughters out, for my mother to keep her secrets, all of these were kind of forces that were outside of themselves. And so I used what's called a visual metaphor, like you had this kind of wind chime that I created with their picture faces in there. And that was to really indicate that they were not in control of their lives, that a lot of these things happened as a result of these outer forces, you know, shape certain decisions. And so, you know, to put a number of years it took, I went to Cuba for the first time in 1998, but I went to China for the first time in 1979, so you saw some clips of my work. But all of these became kind of pieces in my puzzle of understanding the journey of my family and an aspect of who they were. So China Len and my father was meeting my father's family for the first time. And that was early on when they were just allowing people to visit. And so the house that I visited that has since been knocked down many years ago is now a shopping mall and a Nike store. and that says a lot about where China is now, right? So it really was gathering and trying to figure out all these disparate pieces of storytelling to weave it in a way that hopefully was somewhat seamless. You could follow it, but also get not only the mini picture, but the larger picture. And that meant doing lots of drafts, you know, and lots of cuts. And in fact, because I'm trained as a journalist, I was kind of going to tell the story of my mother. And I would show friends trailers that I cut. And they said, you know, every time I see that, it's not as interesting as when you talk about it. I think you have to be in the film. And I was trying like heck to not be in the film. And I didn't. And so one time a friend of mine, who happens to be an author in her own right, Ruth Ann Lum McCunn, said, why don't I interview you and you could use the footage or not use it? Let's just see what happens. And as it turned out, it was helpful. And you know, I finally had to admit it was a story about my mother and I and our relationship, you know, and in the ways in which we had this conflict of her need for privacy and my need to know. You know, that was the central struggle there. Right. Yes?
How accessible is this, for instance, if I want to recommend this to my daughters to see?
A couple of ways. One is that if you hold a library card for New York Public Library, there's a series, catalog called Canopy with a K, K-A-N-O-P-Y, and you can stream it. I also brought some copies, you know, for your home collection at $20. So if you wanted to buy one, you could buy it here. But those are the ways, and then I do some various screenings. But, you know, Canopy is great. They even have couple of my other films, Carved in Silence, the Angel Island one, and also China Land of My Father. Yeah.
Canopy.
Yes.
.com or .org?
I'm sorry?
Canopy.
I think it's canopy.com. You know, you would look up on your New York Public Library. Yeah, and then universities have it too. If you're attached to a university, a lot of the universities have that as well. Yeah. So it's been a means of making a lot of really great documentaries available. You know, they have a terrific catalog. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for coming. I'm here. If you have anything else you want to say to me, I'm here. Thank you.